برنامه نانگار سرخ رو نگاه میکنید، مجله اجتماعی سیاسی که به زبانهای انگلیسی و فارسی روی کانال جدید پخش میشه. سلام به همگی، من مریم نمازیم
و من فریبرز پویا هستم. در برنامه این هفته مصاحبه‌ای داریم با آژانتا دبروی از سکولاریستای بنگلادش که خودش روی لیست مرگ اسلامی است.
در ضمن در رابطه با سفر روحانی به اروپا و یه مسئله با شراب صحبت خواهیم کرد و اعتراضات در آذربایجان ایران علیه نژادپرستی جمهوری اسلامی علیه ترک زبان ها، اعتراضاتی که در افغانستان صورت گرفت علیه سنگسار و کشته شدن تعدادی از مردم اونجا. در ضمن در رابطه با یک کافه ای از کسایی که از حملات اسید دارن زندگی میکنن و علیه وضعیتشون دارن مبارزه میکنن و یه فتوایی که واقعی نیست ولی چون انقدر خنده داره در رابطه با مردانی که میتونن همسراشون رو بخورن وقتی خیلی گرسنه شونه، گفتیم anyway حرفشو میزنیم اینجا. نن اینجایی، با ما باشید. هفته‌ای که گذشت روحانی به اروپا مسافرت کرد و خب در سفرش به ایتالیا و فرانسه یه اسکاندالی شروع شد و این بود که خب دولت فرانسه ایشون رو برای شام دعوت کردن و ایشون گفتن که نه فقط خودشون بلکه هیچکی توی شام اجازه ندارن شراب بخورن و غذاهای غیر حلال بخورن و خب دست دولت فرانسه در نکنه که چیز کرد دیگه، شامو
کنسل کردن. سوال بر سر اینه که
آخه تو فرانسه اگر با غذا شراب نخوری که این بدتر از نمیدونم چیه.
برنامه‌های نانگل سرخ هم همینطوریه.
کفره، کفرگوییه.
تو برنامه‌های نانگل سرخ هم همینطوریه. ولی موضوع اصلی اینه چه چیز روحانی رو چرا دعوت کردن توی کشور اروپا؟ کسی که در تحت دوران ریاست جمهوری خودش بیش از 2000 نفر اعدام شدن توی ملایام، توی دورانی که حتی رئیس جمهورم نبود توی ایران مسئول کشتار خیلی ها بوده، دستش توی جنایت خیلی در واقع خیلی ربط داره به این آقا. جمهوری اسلامی من نمایندهشو به نظر من اصلا نباید دعوت کنن توی اروپا.
نه فقط نباید دعوت کنن برای شام، نه فقط باید شامشو قدغن کنن، بلکه باید این آدمو بندازن تو زندان. واقعا باید دادگاهی بشه، زندانی بشه این آدما. واقعا یعنی داریم نگاه میکنیم هر روز مادران علیه اعدام، نمیدونم زندانیان سیاسی، فعالین کارگری توی زندانن، هر روز این اخبار میاد، بعد اینا دارن قشنگ فرش قرمز برای اینا پخش میکنن فقط به خاطر اینکه میخوان روابط اقتصادی بهبود پیدا کنه که بتونن پول در بیارن.
روابط اقتصادی هم بهبود زندگی مردم نیست، در
برای خود جیب خودشون،
در شرکت هایی که میخوان رابطه با مافیای اسلامی داشته باشن و این کار اشتباهیه.
و خب در رابطه ایران هم که داریم صحبت میکنیم، خب اخیراً هم اعتراضات زیادی بوده توی ایران در رابطه با نژادپرستی خود مطبوعات جمهوری اسلامی علیه مردم ترک زبان.
و واقعیتش اینه که مطبوعات جمهوری اسلامی رادیو تلویزیونش کاملا کنترل شده، با حساب این کارو میکنن، هر روز یکی از بخشی از مردم جامعه رو مسخره میکنن. ویدیوهای خود سران جمهوری اسلامی هستن که توی روابط خصوصی چجوری توهین میکنن به زبانهای مختلف. ولی در اعتراض به این وضعیت مردم اومدن تظاهرات کردن، اعتراض کردن و وضعیتیه که کاملا نشون میده که جامعه ایران نجات پرستی مذهبی جمهوری اسلامی رو نمیپذیره. این به نظر من مهمه که باید به این قضیه توجه کرد.
دقیقا تو خود افغانستان هم اعتراضات زیادی بوده، یکی علیه سربریده شدن یه تعدادی از مردم هزاره و اعتراضاتی بود علیه طالبان، علیه داعش و اعتراضاتی بود علیه سنگسار رخشانا که واقعا پلاکاردهای خیلی زیبایی داشتن. یکیش این بود که میگفت دستان تاجران دین کوتاه تا هر روز ناظر زجرکش شدن فرخنده ها و رخشانه ها نباید شد.
همینطور که تو ایران اون میبینید که دولت در واقع یکی از ستونای اصلی این نوع جنایت هست. توی افغانستان هم همینطوریه، میبینیم که طالبان اگه دولت افغانستان از اینا پشتیبانی نمیکرد، فضا رو براشون باز نمیکرد، این کار اجازه توانایی این کار نداشتن و اجازه نمیداد این کار بکنه.
مسئولین چون یه گروهی فرستاده، خب دولت قانی فرستاده برای اینکه برن تحقیق کنن که چه اتفاقی افتاده در رابطه با سنگسار رخشانه، و کسی که فرستادن برای این تحقیق یکیشون یک کسی هست که توی شورای سراسری علماست به اسم مولوی عنایت الله بلیغ، و ایشون گفته که سنگسار اگر کسی رابطه خارج از ازدواج داشته باشه باید سنگسار بشه، فقط مشکلش اینه که چطوری باید سنگسار بشه، آیا درست سنگسارش کردن یا نه.
این مثل رفرمیستای ایرانه که میگن قانون چیزه. دقیقاً اینا این کاری که کردن خیلی جالبه. دولت افغانستان، فهم شما وقتی گوش میکنین به صحبت‌های توی ظاهرا پارلمان افغانستان، که پارلمان نمیشه اسمش گذاشت، مجلس مرتجعین افغانستان، وقتی گوش میکنی هیچ کدومش اعتراض نمیکنه، فقط یه خانم بلند شد میگه فقط این کار درست نیست، این زیاد در با روح شریعه چیز نیست، خانایی نداره. ولی تمام کسایی که اونجا صحبت میکردن از در دفاع، در واقع در دفاع از قوانین شریعه و سنگسار صحبت میکردن، و خود دولت افغانستان بخش مهمی از مشکل مردم افغانستانه. ولی در این حال تظاهرات و اعتراضات مردم افغانستان نشون میده که جامعه افغانستان نمیخواد این وضعیت و در واقع خسته شده و یه پایان این قضیه باید اعلام بشه.
دقیقا، یعنی واقعا دیگه رخشانه باید آخرین سنگسار این قرن باشه. واقعا بعد انقدر فشار گذاشت که دیگه این واقعا یه چیز شنی و دیگه اصلا نبینیم نشنویم، تموم شده باشه، توی زباله‌دان‌های تاریخ بندازیمش. فتوای احمقان این هفته از شیخ عبدالعزیز بن عبدالله از عربستان سعودی، و خب خودش گفته که این فتوا رو نداده، ولی چون اینقدر احمقانه است گفتیم به کسایی که جدی گرفته بودن فتواشو، که گفته بود اگر یه شوهری خیلی گرسنه نشه، دیگه زیادی گرسنه نشه، میتونه همسر خودشو بخوره. چون
فقط گشنگی توی شرایطی قرار گرفته باشه که هیچ چیزی نداشته باشه و سوال برسم شما امکان داره مرگ باشه یا همسرم بخورم، مرده حق داره که همسرشو بخوره.
کارت چنگا برداره. برای ما گفتیم که سریع بهتون بگیم که این یه فتوای واقعی نیست، نکنه با کارت چنگا بالای سر همسرتون بایستادیم.
ولی حقیقت اینه که این فتوا البته آقا گفته خودش نیستن، و یه مسئله ای که از بین حکومت اسلامی و عربستان سعودی اینا هستن، فتواهای هم مسخره میکنن، خیلی جالبه.
آره دقیقا.
اینم و یه مقدارم انقدر این فتوا مسخره چیز بود به شدت توی میدیای اجتماعی چیز کرد پخش شد، ولی آقا خود این آقا نمیدونم خودش یا گفته بود که نگفته یا گفته ترسیده از نتایجش، گفته که من
ترسیده.
گفته که من این حرفو نزدم و این فتوای در واقع به من بستن این حرفا.
خب پس به هر حال مراقب خودتون باشین، چون این فتوا واقعی نیست، وقتی واقعی شد بهتون میگیم که بیاین با چنگالو
همسرتون رو بخورید.
در شهر آگرا در هند یک کافه‌ای به وجود اومده از با کمک‌های مالی مردم، مثل همون سایت پیتریانی که به برنامه ما کمک می‌کنه، یه کمکی شده برای یک کافه‌ای که بازماندگان و کسایی که نجات یافتن از حملات اسید پاشی، اینا اومدن یک کافه درست کردن و اونو میچرخونن کافه را،
و خیلی مورد استقبال عمومی قرار گرفته. و اهمیت این قضیه اینه که نه تنها با اسید پاشی مبارزه میکنه، به خصوص این قضیه در رابطه جامعه ایران هم خیلی اهمیت داره. سال پیش همه به خاطر دارن که دولت ایران پشت اسید پاشی های خیلی فراوانی بود و با اعتراض عمومی مردم این قضیه فعلا خاتمه پیدا کرده، و اهمیت این قضیه کافه هنگ اوت در واقع قهرمانان زن اینه که با صورتشون اومدن و دارن کار میکنن، منبع درآمدشون هست، و جامعه میتونه تو صورت اینا واقعیت یک جنایت عظیم را در این حال ببینه و در و مقاومت اینا و مقاومت زیبای
به خصوص چون یه طوری هست که خیلی کسایی که مورد حملات اسید پاشی شدن خب احساس میکنن باید قایم بشن میدونی چون یه حمله شده به فیزیکشون و به روحشون به خود انسانیتشون ولی در این حال نشون میده که نه اون انسانیت اونجاست مقاومه و اتفاقا داره میاد و توی ملأ عام
مقاومت میکنه
فقط با بودن خودش در ملأ عام یه نوع مقاومت خیلی مهمه
و چطوری جامعه اینا رو در بغل خودش قرار گرفته و داره ازشون چیز میکنه ازشون حمایت میکنه و اگه رفتین تاج محل فراموش نکنید که حتما به این کافه سر بزنید.
اخیراً مصاحبه داشتم با آژانتا دبروی. ایشون یک سکولاریست بنگلادشی هستند که روی یه لیست مرگ اسلامیای اون کشور قرار گرفتن در رابطه با وضعیت آزاد اندیشان در بنگلادش و در ضمن مقاومت خود ایشون و دیگران علیه اسلامیان اون کشور باشون صحبت کردن. به این مصاحبه خیلی جالب بیاریم با هم نگاه کنیم. با ما باشید.
Welcome, Ajanta. I wanted to ask you about the situation in Bangladesh, particularly for free thinkers.
Thank you so much for inviting me here today. And yeah, the situation in Bangladesh is like well publicized internationally. So you know already what's been happening in Bangladesh for the last 7 months. There's already five killings in 7 months and three more are critically injured. So the situation is really, really worrying right now.
Yeah. And what, you know, what's surprising, I think, or very, you know, angers a lot of people is the fact that the government isn't really doing anything and also sometimes making excuses.
Yeah, you were right. Actually, the thing is when the first murder happened, or Avijit Roy, we expected the government to take action rapidly because he was a very well-known writer and his father is a well-known professor in Dhaka University. He is a well-known writer as well. But surprisingly, the Prime Minister, she called Ajoy Roy, Abhijit's father, but secretly, because they didn't want to publish it to the media, or they didn't want anyone to know that the Prime Minister actually showed sympathy to an atheist father. And the government is playing the religion card to keep those, you know, it's like they're repeatedly making concessions with those fundamentalist extremists because they know that there are like a huge number of people taking the side of those extremists because of the religion card that they are playing. And more surprisingly, the Prime Minister's son, he already clearly said that they cannot take a direct stand for these killings of the free thinkers. And also the recent murder that happened of publishers, Deepon, he was killed. He was one of the publishers who published Abhijit Roy's book. And the Home Minister, he said, this is an isolated incident and this kind of situation and this kind of murders is happening in all over the world. That means he's not, either he's not giving importance to this sort of killings, otherwise he's just denying it just to, you know, just to show that, just to deny the responsibility that he has failed. He doesn't want to accept the failings in that matter. So this situation is really worrying because the government has completely failed to address the situation because no one from the government, Prime Minister, Home Minister, or no one from the government has given any speech yet that can comfort us that they are taking this matter seriously, and also the police they're not showing any actions. Even a police officer got killed the same way. They didn't even shoot the killers. The one officer got killed, 3-4, they ran away and they had the gun with them, but they didn't shoot anybody. So this kind of situation, and only after the killings, they ordered that, okay, you can shoot the killers if somebody attack you. I don't know why they didn't do it before. So this is upsetting.
Especially also, in fact, the more concessions you give to Islamists, the more they take. So the more violence there will be, the more killing there will be. It's like a vicious circle, isn't it?
Exactly, because the more you show that you are actually making concessions to the killers or to the religious fundamentalists, and he was showing that, okay, after every killing, what they're saying, okay, we condemn the killing, but you should not write this things. They're like creating limit boundaries for the writers. They're trying to indirectly like justify the killings, that you are getting killed because you're writing. So these kind of things are indirectly actually how can I say that, actually motivating or
encouraging
the killers to do it, that they can get away with the killings. I want to mention that, you know, Rajiv Haider Shobhan, the first blogger who got killed after Shabak started, his murder case just started moving this year. So after 2 years, you know, and also Washikur Babu's killers got arrested by the people nearby, but there's nothing, no trial started yet. So it's like they are making concessions, they're not doing, you know, the cases are not taking seriously. It has to be done by, you know, quick trials. That demand was that you have to bring them under justice and under quick investigation and quick trial, but they're not doing any sort of things, and they're, you know, it's like a most relaxed approach in addressing the bloggers' killings and also in taking actions.
I mean, and it's also not just a issue for people in Bangladesh. There's a lot of Bangladeshis here in Britain as well who are concerned and feel threatened. Tell us, and I think you're one of those people as well. Tell us a bit about what's happened around that.
Actually, like I said, there's like so many things is happening since 2013. It's nothing new. Since Shabak started, we started our movement like aligned with the movement back home. It was a movement against the war criminals of 1971 and the Jamaat-e-Islami, the fundamentalist, religious fundamentalist group of Bangladesh who opposed our liberation in 1971 and who are still doing anti-liberation activities and spreading fundamentalism, religious violence, and who we think are behind all those extremists and all the organizations. They're like the parent organization of all extremist Islamic extremist organization. That's what we believe. So since it started, we started our like our movement here, but surprisingly there was no attack. Like in Bangladesh they were doing the protest in peace while the police were giving them protection, and the police were there, and nothing happened in first 1 week. But we got attacked the very first day in Altabali Park on 8th February. They were like, police were there, but they didn't do anything because they were like, the Jamaat-e-Islami, local Jamaat-e-Islami, and their supporters were there on the park on that day, on 8th February. From our side, there were like children, there were women, people from different ages, we were there. And on the other side, there were like only men with like tupis, like head covers, and like strong men from... And they were like throwing abuses at us openly. They were throwing eggs, they were throwing stones, water bottles, cans. Police, I went as an organizer, I went repeatedly to ask the police for help. They were saying, no, it's happening from both sides. They didn't want to address that it's happening. And what happened after the protest broke, when we were coming out of Altabali Park, we actually got physically attacked in front of police. Like about 8 of our activists were attacked. They punched on the face, they kicked our protesters, they were chasing one or two of them through Brick Lane. But you know, there was no investigation, no one was arrested, nothing happened. And since then, I was getting threats. There was a hit list in 2013 of 10 UK activists and bloggers and writers. Like, and on that I was the only woman named on that hit list. I went to police several times and I demanded an investigation. I even had a meeting with the Met Police High Commander. They assured me that they're going to look into this matter seriously. But I found out very recently that my case was closed within 2 months. This year, again, once that these killings started, like what happened? It's very disturbing that I couldn't go home in last 2 years because of this stress, because I know that if I go home I'll be attacked, and things don't be like Abhijit. He couldn't survive for 2 weeks. He was murdered. After Abhijit's murder, there was another hit list from the UK of 10 activists. I went like that. That this time, somebody from Scotland Yard, counter-terror intelligence officer, they contacted me that your name is there. Are you aware of that or not? I requested a panic alarm that I need a panic alarm to give me. They came to my house and they checked the security and all that. They only sent me a safeguarding instruction, but they closed my case. They didn't do any investigation. After that, there was another global hit list that came out and it was well advertised internationally. It was in Guardian, BBC, CNN, just you name it, you know, it was everywhere. I went to the police to show them that, you know, this is a hit list from Ansarullah who's on a killing spree back in Bangladesh. So, and I gave them the Facebook link from where I got it. I gave them the screenshot, everything. But like the officer there was not helpful at all. They were like showing, okay, it can happen because you have a different political opinion and all. They took it serious. They showed that, okay, we will do something. We'll let you know. After 1 or 2 weeks, they sent me an email that they're closing the case.
Didn't they say something like, activists should expect getting these sorts of problems?
They say that later on. What happened afterwards is more, even more interesting. And then one newspaper in Bangladesh, it's a national newspaper, they started, they published a news with my name and another fellow activist's name. Her name was also there on the global hit list. And then they did, they publicized that we are doing some international activities from here and Australia cricket team, they canceled their tour to Bangladesh because of me and I'm the one responsible for it. And they stole my picture from Twitter and they posted on the national newspaper. It was a like headline newspaper with red ink. And then it went virally online and people were posting abusive words, swearing at me, sexual threats and all. And I didn't know what to do. I was so scared about the safety of my family back home. And one morning, the police officer, like the IGP of police of Bangladesh, she's like the additional IG of police of Bangladesh. He, on a television talk show, in a national television, he was saying the same thing that me, my other colleague, and somebody from Israel is plotting against Bangladesh and doing, you know, these things.
And what did the police say to you when they heard all of this as well?
What happened? I confronted the IGP on live TV and he backed down a little bit and he was... But when I went to the police here, this time I took Gita Shagal with me because she knows my case from 2013. So I thought, okay, they're not taking me seriously. So let me take somebody who... you know, who is well known and they will take it seriously again. I took her with me, the police officer there, she was like, there was a barrier there. There were not even, you know, barrier between me and her, but she still wrote the case and I told her everything. I showed her the case and everything. After 2-3 days, somebody called me from the police station and he was telling me, unfortunately, we are going to close your case again because, you know, I actually complained with Gita. I actually complained to them. You know, I want to complain because I'm coming to you. You know my face because this is the same police station that I'm going. You know my face. Whenever I come to you, you start saying, hello, how are you now? Like, that means you know me, my case. But you're still closing my cases without doing any investigation. And you were saying that you don't have any... evidence or anything to do it, but well, I'm providing you with evidence. So the police officer who called me, he said, you know, we are closing your case because we don't have any anything to go on with the investigation, and we have provided you with a safeguarding instruction. I think that should be enough, and we don't think you are under threat. I was like, you don't think I'm under threat? I'm getting, these are the abuses I'm getting. He's like, if you are an activist, this is normal. If you were in politics, this is normal. People will have different opinion against you, and they will say it. And if you don't like it, come out of online. Why do you go and see it?
Well, it's outrageous, sort of blaming you again for
exactly.
The threats. What can people do both against the Bangladeshi government, which has to be held responsible, as well as to get the police to do something here? What are your suggestions? What can people do?
Actually, from last few months, what we are expecting, like whoever we are in outside Bangladesh, like me, Bonna, Abhijit's wife, and like other activists and everyone. What I can say, everyone, we are trying to get international community involved and trying to create a pressure on our government so that they take immediate action against those killers and at least address the situation that this is a situation that we have to deal with. What our government is doing, they are not even addressing that there is a problem. To deal with a problem, you have to address it. They're not addressing the problem. They're trying to mark it as isolated incidents, and they're not. We don't see enough arrests. We don't see whoever got arrested. Not the trial hasn't started yet. So we want the community to come forward, whoever are working with the bloggers issues and the free thinking issues, because this is a very serious matter. It's not only Bangladesh issue now, it's like an international issue, and all over the world it will affect you. Maybe today it's Bangladesh, tomorrow it can be UK, because I received a threat very recently from somebody in Facebook, and that person had a profile, it's like somebody, a supporter of ISIS, and had like around 1500 friends who had like something ISIS flags, profiles and everything. I sent it to the police, but I haven't received any reply from them yet. So it is a serious issue, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it is, as you say, this is all our fights, and we have to show solidarity and make sure action is taken. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
امیدوارم از اون مصاحبه خوشتون اومده باشه. به نظرم آژانتا دبروی مسائل خیلی مهمی رو مطرح میکنه. یه واقعیت اینه که یه جنگ تمام عیار علیه آزاداندیشان بنگلادش در اون کشور داره صورت میگیره از طریق اسلامیون، که خود دولت بنگلادش هم درش دست داره، سکوت کرده و اجازه میده که اسلامیون بالاخره هر کاری میخوان انجام بدن.
دقیقاً این یکی از خصوصیات این اتفاقی داره میفته، و در واقع رشد جنایت اسلامی کاملا ربط داره به دولت‌ها توی خاورمیانه و شمال آفریقا. اینو کاملا میتونیم ببینیم توی افغانستان هم که صحبت می‌کنیم، چه دولت اجازه میده این رشد بکنه. توی بنگلادش هم اینطوریه، دولتش گفته که من این زیاد اهمیت نداره، یا نکنین اگه ناراحتین از این وضعیت. و این نکته خیلی مهمیه که آژانس در موردش صحبت میکنه.
خود پلیس انگلیس هم خب بالاخره الان یه لیستی هست از کسایی که مورد اسلامی میخوان بکشن، و خب یه تعدادشون تو خود انگلیس زندگی میکنن، و پلیس اینجا گفته خب هر کسی که فعاله ممکنه اذیت بشه، و خب اگر خوشتون نمیاد فعالیت نکنید. همیشه میندازن گردن کسی که مورد تهدید قرار میگیره و نه علیه خود اسلامیونی که دارن این کارو میکنن.
دقیقاً یه موقعی میرسه که اگه دولت‌ها نتونن آزادی فردی و آزادی زندگی مردم دفاع کنن، مردم چه راه حلی دارن؟ قدرتی که شروع کنن از خودشون دفاع کردن. این راه حلیه که تنها جلوی مردم میذارن، که مردم شروع کنن دفاع از خود رو سازمان بدن. در به خاطر این قضیه فکر کنم توی بنگلادش داره شکل میگیره، و مقاومت در این حال، مقاومت در برابر این وضعیت خیلی وجود داره. اینجوری نیست که فقط اسلامیا یه بخشی از این نیرو هستن، بخش دیگه‌ش اینه که مردم مقاومت دارن میکنن، و آژانتا خودش بخشی از این مقاومت.
دقیقاً از بنگلادش تا افغانستان و ایران مقاومت واقعا قویه، انسانیه، و خب مورد حمایت تمام جهان باید بشه. امیدوارم از برنامه این هفته خوشتون اومده باشه. مثل همیشه واقعا برای ما باعث خوشحالیه که براتون برنامه سازمان بدیم. امیدوارم که تماسای خودتون رو ادامه بدین. واقعا برای ما یه چیز دلگرمیه، نه که پیاماتون رو چه از طریق یوتیوب یا فیسبوک و غیره به دستمون برسه. به هر حال تا هفته آینده امیدوارم هفته خیلی خوبی داشته باشین.
از طرف من و مریم نمازی تا هفته آینده، goodbye.
Hi, I'm Mariam Namazi.
And I'm Faribos Puya.
We're hosting a program called Bread and Roses. It's a weekly program that's broadcast in Persian and English in the Middle East and North Africa, primarily Iran as well. And it's also shown on YouTube internationally.
And we've been doing this since last May. We're coming up to our year's anniversary, and we've had quite a lot of fun making these videos.
We discuss taboo-breaking, free-thinking ideas. The Islamic regime of Iran has called us immoral and corrupt.
And that's why you need to support us. We are the alternative voice in Middle East and North Africa.
Of corruption and immorality. So do support us. Here's a short video from Patreon that explains how you can help us with even just $1 a week. That's nothing. Support us.
Patreon lets fans become patrons of their favorite artists and content creators. It's different than Kickstarter because it's not about one big project that requires lots of funding. It's more for bloggers or YouTubers or webcomics, anyone who creates on a regular basis. Here's how it works. When you become a patron, you're agreeing to give an artist a tip of an amount you set every time they release a piece of content, whether it's a new song, a video, or a recipe. You can set a monthly maximum to make sure that you're always within your budget. Choose an amount, enter your payment information, and you're done. Becoming a patron allows you to view and post in the artist's stream, and in exchange for your support, artists offer additional patron packages, which might include monthly Google Hangouts, music production tutorials, pre-sale concert tickets, or anything they can offer as a way to say thanks. Patreon, empowering a new generation of content creators.